Hey there folks, welcome back to the Speaker Builder channel, and we're today talking all about speaker wire, and we're asking the proverbial question, what difference does it make? We want to know, do I have to spend crazy money on speaker cable, or can any kind of stuff do? We've seen lots of different kinds of speaker wire out there at different prices. So I wanted to sort of tackle that question. I've wanted to do this for a while, and I just never get around to doing it. And there was a unique opportunity here where I had some of this old Mogami hanging around. I had some of this acoustic research stuff hanging around. I had pulled these off of my satellite speakers. This is super classic cable. And then I had my FT4. I had taken this project apart. This is the active speakers. So I have a bunch of this FT4 wire I've used in a bunch of projects here in Speaker Builder. So I pulled this all out, and so now I have these four different cables. We'll get a close-up of these later, to look at and to compare. And so I wanted to ask that question, what do these cables actually sound like? And the nice thing about this, not being an electronics engineer, I can't speak to all, I know something about skin effect and things like that, and I read this stuff. But I don't really know all the electronics of all this, and I don't need to know all the engineering behind all this. I'm down here where the rubber meets the road, and I'm asking the question, can I hear the difference? There is obviously going to be a difference in how the different kinds of wires handle the electrical signals, the acoustic signals coming down these wires. The question is, can we hear that difference? So there is a difference, there always is going to be a difference, but can we hear the difference? That's the big question, and that's that I can handle because I'm a listener. And so I'm just putting my ears on this problem and asking that question and seeing if I can hear the difference. So, and I'd love to hear from others about their experiences. Now, let me do one more thing before I give you the headline. I am not talking about here these big money speaker cables that can be purchased from various manufacturers, and they're hundreds of dollars for runs of 10 or 20 feet. I don't have any experience of those. I have never felt obliged to spend that kind of money. And so there may be folks out there who have done that. I'd love to hear from you, especially if you've done A/B testing, as I've done here. But we're down in this lower end of the spectrum. We're talking of a speaker cable costing 50 cents a foot, all the way up to 225 per foot. And then the other super classic, it's a super, I'll have to look it up again. Anyway, it's under $4 a foot. And that's the stuff that I'd really like to buy if I had money to spend and I needed good wire, I might buy that stuff $4 a foot. So everything from 50 cents all the way up to $5 a foot is the kind of world that I'm in and the world that I'm talking about. So not crazy money, any of that. Even at $5 a foot, you're only talking for 2 10-foot lengths, you're talking $100 total. So everywhere from $10 to $100, that's the range we're in. And that's not outrageous. If you've got a $2,500 speaker sound system or $5,000 system or something, whatever, it makes sense to spend $100 for speaker cables. But so let me give the headline then. So we're not talking about the high-end stuff. We just talked down here. We're down here in the reasonable end, stuff that I can buy by the foot and that I can put together myself. I like to run the 10-foot links. I don't know if that really makes much difference, whether it's 10 or 20 feet. There are some theoretical limitations to, say, 16-gauge wire. You can only run it just so. I think it's 50 feet is the limit. But anyway, I'm down at the 10-foot range. I like to keep it at 10 feet. So let me give the headline now. The headline is, yes, there is a difference in these cables and how they perform. Now, that would make sense just looking at the architecture, the very different architectures of this Mogami against this FT4 or against a more standard kind of a speaker cable like the Super Classic or this acoustic research. So there is going to be a difference in how the cables handle the signals. The question is, can you hear that difference? Is it a difference that makes a difference? And that's the question I'm wrestling with today. And again, this is down at the slower end, 50 cents or a couple dollars a foot. So the headline is, yes, there is a difference. Yes, you can hear the difference. But now I need to give us some qualifiers to that. First of all, we need to understand this difference is not going to be gigantic. It's relatively small compared to other differences I've heard in systems. For example, I've owned 3 CD players over the course of years, and with each CD player upgrade, there's been a significant, very easily noticeable difference and the performance of each CD player moving up. I have also, for as in another example, three amplifiers here. They're all made by Rotel. They're all 50 watts a channel. They're all about $300, $400, $500. But there is a very significant difference between them, between these three, if I were to just identify these three. There are others I have. There's very little difference between one or the other, but I can put three here and play them, and there's very significant differences between them. So there's some pretty significant differences in CD players and amplifiers, you know, receivers, things like that, that are more significant than the differences I'm hearing in speaker cable. So we're not talking about dramatic differences here. We're talking about small differences. Now, having said that, how are we going to be able to detect those small differences? Well, we'd have to have a pretty clean system in order to hear that. So if we hear from folks who say, Jeff, I've tried this cable, that cable, I've spent all this money, I can't hear any difference. In some cases, there may be no difference that's detectable, depending on the system they're listening to. If they have a budget system, and that's all the money we have is a couple hundred dollars, and that's what we have, that's fine. If you got $400 or $500 worth of hi-fi stuff, but at that price range, down at that range, you may not be able to hear any difference between some of the cables that I have here, because the clarity of the system is limited. And so, you know, that makes sense. The signal has to come through every single component as it goes along and comes out the other end. And if all, and if the number of those components have some fair amount of sonic limitations to them, then you can put all the cleanest wire in that signal chain that you want. You're not going to hear that difference because there are all the other restrictions are going to constrain that clarity. So you have to have a system that's going to be able to reveal the differences. So that speaks to one kind of an issue. First of all, if you have a budget system, I wouldn't just run this junk speaker wire, you know, this kind of, you know, the stuff you get. I got this at Radio Shack. This is a really bad example because it's a example of bad wire, because it's all oxidized on one end, and it's different kinds of metals, and it's crazy stuff. But just cheap speaker wire. But if it's all you have, I would at least go to the trouble to buy. I can't find this acoustic research stuff, but there's stuff on Parts Express that's very similar to this. Big heavy rope wire, 12 gauge or whatever. I would buy that at 50 cents a foot before and get rid of the 18 gauge, you know, cheapy cables that you might have. So I would go that far at least, and a 210 foot runs at 50 cents a piece is $10. So that's not a lot of money. I would at least do that. Oh, if you have an inexpensive system. But I would, my guess would be that at the lower end, you might not even hear any difference if you spend a lot more than that. You might go up into the, say, I take that suggestion of the Supra. I'll look up the name of it, but it's under $4 a foot. But you compare those two, I can hear the difference between these two, but and this is not the $4, this is only $1.65 a foot, and I can hear a difference between these two cables, but because of the system I put together, it's going to reveal that difference. So anyway, that's a cautionary note here, that if some folks are out there saying, I've spent all this money on speaker cable, I A-B tested them, and I heard no difference, well, your system might not be able to reveal that difference. So let me talk about the system I put together and how I was able to reveal that difference. And so first off, I had to decide when I went to test these cables how to do it. I have a lot of active speakers, and then I have some full passive speakers like these satellites I have here, and this 8-inch two-way full range system I have. And I have another small set of 6.5 two-way Sonys. I didn't replace the tweeters in those. They're just kind of thrown together. They're repaired. They're factory speakers that have been repaired with a new bass driver. But they weren't set up as a full range. Neither is that the case here, because I've replaced these tweeters now, and so who knows where that system's at. This is really the only full range speaker system that I have that's with a passive crossover that has been set up with Madisound's Leap software for the crossover. I didn't spend crazy money on these drivers, but I did the system right. So this is the only system I really have that's full range. Now, I had to decide with active speakers whether I wanted to try to test the speaker wire out in an active system. In other words, running just a tweeter through the different cables, or just a mid-range, or just a bass through the different cables. That was going to be more extensive, more involved. And the issue there is whether if it performs well in one situation with just one driver, you know, being only burdened by one narrow range of the frequency spectrum, would it perform equally well at full range? And that, you know, that gets into complicated stuff. The issue is, for me, I think, is that for application purposes, as I share this with folks, my assumption is going to be that you either have a full range speaker system, like a tower speaker or something, or and that's a passive crossover, and you're going to run the full frequency spectrum through the cable, or you have a pair of satellites which are nearly full range, say 100 cycles all the way up. And so you need the, your cables are going to be carrying nearly or the complete range of frequencies. And so my testing then, I felt, needed to burden the cable with the full frequency spectrum to give it the full test. So that's what I decided to do. And so I pulled these out because they are full range, 8-inch two-way. They sound really good. One of this interesting little side point is that I've gained a great deal more appreciation for full range passive speakers, especially a two-way, doing this because I really was able to make these talks. So I needed to then, first of all, test these cables out in full frequency spectrum so that they were demanded to carry the high frequencies, the mids, the lows, the whole thing, and to see how they performed. The secondary advantage to doing that was that I was able to listen to the whole frequency range and see how the cable performed in the lows and the mids and the highs, you know, the full range, compared to if I just did it with active speakers and I was only listening to just one driver. So I could sort of assess the entire frequency spectrum capability of each cable by doing it that way. So now, as I mentioned earlier, if you have a budget system, you might not hear this difference. So, and that's fine. If you have budget, just buy something halfway decent anyway. Spend $10 on cables, right? But do you need to spend $50, $80, $100 on cables? You'd have to hear a difference. So now, if you have a more expensive system, then you probably can hear a difference, and it would warrant then a little bit more money, right? So that kind of goes together. You do want to kind of match components. I've always felt that way. If you have a $100 CD player, it's not much sense having, you're going to really lose out if you have high-end other components and you've got a really inexpensive component in one end of that signal chain. So you kind of have to match your components. So here's what the system that I set up. I went to my top of the mountain system. I used the $500 Rotel CD player, which I know what that sounds like in my top of the mountain system. It's really, really clean, much cleaner than the others that I've had. I went through the control amp, which is $500-$600. I don't think that makes any difference in the single chain. Then I went to the amplifiers of the 1050, Rotel 1050s that I have, one of those. And I know that's a really clean, that's one of the three amps I mentioned earlier. I know that's a real clean amp. And then I went into these speakers. And so, and what I did with these is I just cut the cables off and I used these connectors. And it was a cool thing, I was able to stick this into the wire in the box and then put wire onto this and then plug it in. So, and then on the back of my amplifier, these connectors could be plugged directly into the back of the amplifier. So I was able, and I got a whole bunch of these. So I was able to hook up these on the different cables. And then when I went to do my test, I could just unplug one cable and plug in the others in. Now, one of the things I was not able to do was to do A-B testing with the two parallel systems, each one with different speaker cables, and then swap between them directly with the same sheet, a piece of music playing. Go directly from one system to the other. Don't have the equipment to do that. That would be nice. It'd be fun if I worked in a hi-fi shop and I could just take speakers and, you know, take two sets of identical speakers, two identical amps to it, you know, a whole complete identical system playing the same music and swap between them and listen. You could do quick right back and forth and you could really hear that difference much more easily. In this case, the system I set up allowed me to swap out the speaker cable in about 30 seconds. So I could listen to a piece of music, sit for about a minute of it, listen to it intently to a 1 minute piece of music that might have special highs or a special bass, put it on pause, switch the cables out, sit back down again within 30 seconds, play that same minute of passage of music. And I had really had to go back and forth. Again, the differences are small. There are differences, but they are relatively small. So I began to, over time, I did this for over a couple of hours, that I was able to begin to assess and discover what the differences are between these four different cables. And then for fun, I did some other things, and I'll show you these. One of the things I wanted to assess was, I have this FT4 wire, and I thought it might not carry the low frequencies very well in my active speakers. So I doubled it up. I bought two runs. It's a different color, but it's the same wire. And I doubled up the runs, and thinking that would produce more bass. And so I've discovered that's not the case. I'm going to get into the details of this. I even tried some, I'll get into close-up. Let me do close-up, and I'll talk about specifically what I discovered. But I even tested out some, this is electrical cable I bought at the hardware store for a different kind of a project, and I happen to have two 10-foot lengths of it, 16-gauge copper wire. So I tried that on my speakers and see how that would perform. And then I have couple other cables. I didn't try this stuff. I knew better. This is oxidized, cheap junk, not even balanced. But I'll look at that for a second. And I also, of course, this stuff is, I tried it single and I tried it doubled up. And so let me zoom in here real close and we'll talk about the different cables and then the things are that I discovered. So let me start with the FT4 wire. This is by AudioQuest. I've talked about this in some of my other projects. I've used this a bunch. It's a very interesting kind of a speaker cable. It has four leads, a small lead, a small single core, large single core, small single core. And you put one of the large and one of the small for plus, and then the other large and small for minus. Does that make sense? Can you see that? So, very interesting architecture for cable. It's not multi-strand like so many speaker cables. And the guys swear by this stuff. And so I wanted to put this into the mix. And so I kind of started with this and then began comparing it to some of the others. Let me go through all the different cables I have first, and then I'll talk about the differences. So that was the first thing I tried. And the second wire is this audio. This is super classic. I'm going to double check my focus, because it's hard to see that. So this is super classic. It's 2.5, 13 gauge. It's $1.68 a foot. You get this at Madisound. And this would be probably a notch up from some of the 50 cent a foot stuff. So I have this stuff here. I took off my satellites, as I said. I just cut it off and tried this out. So that's what that is. Third up, I have... I'm going to have to bring my other cable to show you what this stuff is all about. If I get this into the video, double check my focus. So this is a Mogami, and it's the number is 3082, I think. It's 3082 Mogami speaker. You can still buy this stuff as well. All this stuff is available today. And this Mogami has a center core, and then the other is a coaxial run on the outside of the wire. I'm going to pull out an old form of this stuff, and you'll be able to see that coax a little bit better. This is an earlier form of that same wire. And if I can get that in focus. So I don't know if you can see the coaxial design. This is actually dual coax wire. It's got the outside coax, and then this one's actually coaxed as well. But the issue with this is it's not entirely balanced line, right? It's one of them's coax on the outside, and so the plus will be coax on the outside, the minus on the inside. So anyway, that's what this stuff is. It's a coax speaker cable. So it's a different kind of an architecture than standard kind of a wire like the Supra. So interesting stuff. So I wanted to put that to the test, and then finally, this is classic rope cable, or I think Monster Cable makes this stuff, makes stuff like this. And this is made by Acoustic Research. This is the Pro Cable 12 gauge. It was only 50 cents a foot. You can still buy stuff like this at Parts Express. It's not this manufacturer, it's something else, somebody else, but it's 50 cents a foot. You buy it in 25, 50, 100 foot lengths. So those are the four basic kinds of cables that I tested out. So let me talk about what I discovered now. So beginning with some of my expectations, I had imagined that this was going to be the cleanest wire of all the four types, that it would have the highest it would have the best high frequency response. That would have been my guess. And that turned out to actually be true. And I tested, I pushed the envelope on this. I went back and forth between this and the Supra, between this and the Mogami wire. And of course, I didn't expect the 50 cent a foot acoustic research stuff to perform as well. But against these other two, I wanted to really push the envelope and test that. And so I went back and forth. And by far, each time I tested, I found this stuff was definitely cleaner. You could definitely hear a difference. Again, it wasn't a dramatic difference, not as big a difference as I've heard comparing to CD players or amplifiers, but there was a definite difference. And that's what I've done with this stuff. I've used it for high and mid frequency systems. Now, the other big surprise that I had, that I discovered was that this, when I doubled this stuff up, I hope this is all in focus. When I doubled this stuff up, and I thought the doubling up would help in the low frequency response and allow this to perform better in the low end. You can see it's just two runs of the FT4. I just doubled it. And I found that it did not perform in the low end as well as the Mogami cable did. So that was a surprise. So I learned that. The Mogami definitely had a better low end than the FT4. It was definitely had a warmer character to it. It wasn't as good in the highs, but it was actually better in the lows. And then the Super Classic tended to be kind of between these two. The Super Classic wasn't near as bright as this. It was still, I think it was probably just a tad brighter than the Mogami stuff. But it wasn't as bright as FT4, and then it didn't quite have as the performance on the low end that the Mogami had. Now, I have used this Mogami doubled up like this, and this is another thing I did because it's coax one and center core the other. What I've done, and I'm showing you both of them here, so I connect the center in the coax together for plus, and center and coax here for minus. I don't know if you can see that, if that makes, you can see the white core, so white core and go together like that. So the white core is a plus on one side and it's the minus on the other cable. But anyway, you double it up and you have twice as much wire to go through. But I found actually doubling this up, by the way, to speaking of that, that I couldn't hear a difference between running a single run and running a double run. Having said that, I'm going to put these together and make a double run again. I just like a lot of wire, as you tell with the 12 gauge monster cable stuff. It's like the old monster cable stuff. Big, huge 12 gauge, tons of wire in this. I just like a lot of wire. And so I'm probably going to double this up for bass, whether I can hear that difference much or not. Sometimes you just do it because it makes sense to you. But anyway, so that's a big surprise. I guess I didn't really expect a Mogami to perform as well on the high end, and I did expect the FT4 to perform in the high end, so that turned out to be true. But I was surprised at how the Mogami outperformed the FT4 here in the low end. So this is better in the high end, this is better on the low end. And then this was kind of in between. And then it was a notch down, a tad notch down, to get down to the acoustic research. So that's kind of the basic finding, and so nothing was really a big surprise. Doubling up the FT4, not providing any additional bass was a surprise. The doubling up of the Mogami, not really helping any noticeably in the bass, was a surprise. But otherwise, there wasn't a lot of surprises here. Now I'm gonna go look at this wire here again. I didn't do a close-up of this, but this isn't speaker cable, this is AC cable. If you have a appliance that you've damaged the power cable in, you just go buy this stuff by the foot and replace the power cable on your, you know, your drill or a saw or a vacuum cleaner or some house appliance. And it has good copper leads on it, good copper wire, number 16 gauge, and it performed okay. There wasn't that much difference between this cheap stuff, probably 20 cents a foot. I don't know what I paid for it. And the 50 cents a foot speaker cable. Again, I like big wire, so if I'm gonna buy a speaker cable, I'm gonna spend 50 cents a foot and not be too cheap and squeak too loud. And spend the 50 cents a foot on real speaker wire rather than this. But it was interesting to try to test this stuff out. Did it really fall on its face really, really bad? Only a little, it was a little bit worse in terms of some of the spatial characteristics of it and all that stuff. So this is a very, very typical, I think it's 18 gauge kind of speaker wire you get in little cheap speakers. and or it might come in some of the speakers you buy. And so this is the kind of the stuff that I would be suggesting avoiding. But I thought I would put it into the test here and test it out to see how it performed. And it was surprising what I discovered, that the there was a lack of dynamic. The system started to sound really flat. I mean, it starts to sound like cheap stereo. It was remarkable. There was a loss of dynamics, musical life. I'm looking at my notes here. Flat, lifeless, loss of airiness. The highs were gone, mid-rangey. So it's just, and I compared this to the Supra cable. So it was just, wow. It was just amazing. Now I've got some $500 components, $500 amp, $500 CD player, probably equivalent of a maybe $1,000 speaker system here or $1,500 speaker system. So I've got some decent money I've spent on stuff, but then you put cheap speaker cable wire in there, it really takes the life out of it. So this probably is perfectly fine in my desk speaker, the little desk speakers I have for, for listening to YouTube stuff and whatever. And it probably worked fine. Might not be able to hear a difference. But for a real good stereo system that you spent a couple thousand dollars on, you're going to hear a difference. So that was just interesting to discover how that wire performed, and it wasn't so much highs and lows so much as it was a loss of dynamics. There was a loss of life to this stuff. It was really surprising. So that's about all on the speaker cable. I'd love to hear from other folks. One of the things about termination, since we're that I didn't mention earlier, that in terms of buying speaker cable that's raw by the foot, my recommendation is there are some of these cups that you can buy. I just bought these from my other boxes, and you drill a hole and you cut a hole out and you put it in the back of your speaker box. And these, rather than have those little spring-loaded little clips that you try to stick very small gauge wire in, this is designed for much larger gauge wire. If you open this up, and I'll see if I can get in close on this, and you see how big the hole is. You can see on the red connector how large that hole is. It'll take, I think, 8 gauge or something. So it'll take whatever wire you want to put in it. And so if you have really good speakers, they should have those kind of connectors. And my amplifiers have this same kind of a connector. So, and you could do one of two things with that. The other thing you can do, you can buy this. I bought these at Parts Express, and they plug in. So these are the same thing. They have the large holes, and you have the little screws. You stick the wire into the hole, and you crank the screw down, and it clamps down on the wire, and now you have a quick connect. And you can do, and that's how I did the testing out. I was able to quick connect them in and out. You just plug it in. But these, actually, it makes no sense to have this additional device. You've got the little connectors here. And amplifiers have these. So that's how I would recommend hooking up your speaker wire, putting it directly into the onto the terminals. If you build your own speakers, buy these. This is for a new project I'm working on. And so you can buy raw wire by the foot and just terminate it that way. And it creates, by the way, what's called a gas tight connection. When you crank that down there, it's not a soldered connection. So there's the electrons go directly from the wire core to the connector and then through. So that's how we terminate it. So feel free to leave comments. Love to hear what y'all's experience is with other different kind of cables and whether you've done any A/B testing and what you've discovered. So, and we'll all see y'all next time.